And now for something completely different.
Here's what's coming up this hour on Today's Experience. It's totally terrific, totally transforming. Hey, totally triumphant Tuesday as we find unity from the Father through the Son and by the Holy Spirit, all for the glory of God Almighty. First, we step into a very interesting part of the book of Romans as we pick it up in chapter 7, verse 8. Paul says that sin took advantage of the law. Now listen, that is a striking statement. When he says that sin aroused all kinds of forbidden desires inside of him, that's striking. It's critical for you and me to understand something about sin. And you might not like it, I certainly don't, but it doesn't matter. Sin is a living entity that feeds upon our rebellion towards God. Sin has an appetite. Whoa. Next, in the realization of God's truth and our own sin, we understand within ourselves that we are doomed to die because the penalty for that sin in us is death. Because we've broken the law and we have sinned. Now we come to realize that we deserve death. It's just an inevitability. It's just a response to our wickedness. That's the argument Paul's laying out. The bottom line, of course, is there's just no eternal life apart from Jesus Christ. So finally, in verse 13, Paul says that sin used what was good to bring about this condemnation. It used God's commandments, sin did, for its own evil purposes. That's just what he says. I'm not sure we understand the fullness of how dark and evil sin really is. But the result of sin and its activity is death. So maybe that's a good place to start our understanding of how evil sin really is. Hold on to your hats, because here we go.
David Spoon's life has been an experience. While growing up in a Jewish family, he made a wrong turn towards drug abuse. Then David Spoon found Jesus Christ, and his life completely changed. The more he studied the gospel, the more he wanted to share his experiences with others. After 35 years of ministry, David discovered a new path of service. He joined KAAM, and this radio program began. You're about to hear the David Spoon Experience.
Welcome to the David Spoon Experience, local, national, and heavenly talk. Here's what else we're looking at during the show. Lessons for surviving, living, and prevailing. Politics, entertainment, and current events, personal revelations, spiritual observations, my life's insanities, noive, so much more. Now remember, it's not professional radio, and since I wasn't here yesterday, we're going to have to check in with the dignitary of professional radio, our very own Jammin' Jacob. Jammin' Jacob, is the David Spoon Experience professional radio?
No, it is not, David.
All right. Good job, Mr. Dignitary. Very, very good job.
Thank you, David. Thank you.
You are welcome. Okay, bottom line, it's not professional radio, it's just radio. So relax. But we are asking you, what do you think? So you can email us during the show, and that's cool. We like that, okay? You're welcome to email us during the show. Try not to say too many nasty things. That'd be good. David@hemustincrease.org. That's David@hemustincrease.org. You can text us at 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or you can call us. Really, you can. 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. And when you call 972-445-0770, you'll end up talking to Jammin' Jacob. Talking to Jammin' Jacob is like sharing a cheat meal on your diet with your favorite person. Yay! Hey, 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 ho, 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 ho.
Thank you, David. Happy Tuesday, and welcome back from a, well, not really a day off yesterday, but
nope.
A day not being here.
A day not being here. That's the kind of day it was yesterday. Thank you, my brother. Let me just ask you real quickly. I didn't get a chance to ask you yesterday because I wasn't here. In regards to the weekend, anything special? Any special kind of food?
I did have grilled chicken last night while watching the Saints and Kansas City Chiefs game. So I had some grilled chicken, which was good.
That's nice. That's very good. I had low-calorie peanut butter and chocolate ice cream. I don't know.
Something that's always a guarantee is something to do with peanut butter.
Yes, somehow it will always be there. I know some people have an allergy to it. I have an allergy not to it. See how that works?
If I don't just take like a cup of peanut butter and just eat it? Is it just peanut butter?
I will not answer under the law schematic that I might indict myself as how many times I've done it. Not have I done it. I do not want to even answer that question. And I will not answer that I've taken peanut butter and slapped a piece of chocolate on it together by itself without doing a Reese's and also ate it that way. I am Gil and T, both of those.
Like the what's it, the Tootsie Pop filler? How many times does David eat peanut butter? The world will never know.
The world will never know. Exactly. All right, here's the bottom line. Why would you call us? Why would you text us? And why would you, in fact, email us? It could be for a praise report, because we'd love to hear him. It could be for prayer requests, because we believe prayer works. And it's also can just be because you just, in your heart, you just have something you want to share. You got a scripture. The Lord's giving you some kind of comfort, wisdom, insight, whatever the case may be. Awesome. We think it's phenomenal. We also have the opportunity for you to do Bible trivia. Let's see if you guys can get this one. If you don't get this one, the show is going to shut down. That's that. Who was the father of Cain, Abel, and Seth? Who was the father of Cain, Abel, and Seth? Genesis 4, 1 through 2. Sometimes when we come back on a Monday, we make it a little easier on purpose. Who was the father of Cain, Abel, and Seth? If you think you know, 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. The question, who was the father of Cain, Abel, and Seth? The reference, Genesis 4, 1 through 2. I will not tell you what Al wrote, but it was very funny. We'll just leave it there. I do want you to be aware you are welcome to reach out to us and answer this trivia question. One other thing I did not mention, so I did mention, by the way, we already prayed for the people of North Carolina and Florida. Keep praying for them. I do want you to be aware. We're aware of scratchy internet. We understand. There's a search engine at the bottom of the front page just for the website. It's only going to go through the website, nothing else. And one thing we added to the website, I already told you about the bumper sticker, the cool bumper sticker, rainbow bumper sticker that's about halfway through. They're not available yet, but we're going to be working on that. Takes a little time. I got a lot of stuff I'm doing. But we also have gotten permission as of yesterday. Now, I'm going to be careful how I say this, but everybody knows the political season is increasing. 4 weeks from today, between now and 4 weeks from today, people will be voting. You should vote as the Lord pours it upon your heart. And if the government doesn't like us saying that, too bad. You should vote Bible because God is able to create the universe. He's able to write a book. So let's keep that simple. Go with God in your wisdom and your decisions. And in lieu of that, because we think the whole thing's more humorous than people will confess to, Babylon Bee, a satirical site that does many, many things. If you're offended, don't ever do it. But they have given me personally permission on our website to have a link on our website for people that just want to laugh about the politics. It's on the middle of the website. It says Babylon Bee. All the fake news you can trust. They have given me personally our ministry permission to discuss a few of their articles and also to have a link on the website. And you're thinking, why? And I'll tell you why. Because it makes me laugh. and I'm getting real tired of everything that's on the news that's trying to make me cry or get angry. I want to laugh more. A merry heart does make like medicine. There is enough going on. So we have a link to them with permission from them. If you don't like them, don't go there. But if you do go there and you do enjoy their material, sign up. They got a cool little system, and they got some really funny stuff. And I like their stuff, so I'm just telling you. All right. In the meantime, your trivia question again. Who was the father of Cain, Abel, and Seth? Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 through 2. In the meantime, we'll do our DNA. D stands for draw closer to the Lord.
Daily.
So I'm just curious. Just curious how often daily might be. I'm thinking, what do you think?
I'm thinking it's every day, David.
All right, that's a great answer. Daily means every day.
You are correctamundo.
Correctamundo, sir! All right, draw closer to the Lord daily. D, N, never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. Never be ashamed of what Jesus had to say. Remember, Jesus, his title is the Word of God, John chapter 1, verse 1 through 2. Don't tell that to people who don't know Jesus. They won't have a clue what you're talking about. But the bottom line is, Jesus is the Word of God. And so never be ashamed of Jesus or his words, right? That's the N. And then A. So D, draw closer to the Lord daily. And never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. A, always be ready.
To serve.
To serve. You're ready. You ready? What if the Lord wants you to say something? Great. What if he wants you to pray about something? Great. What if he wants you to smile? Great. Text, smile, whatever. Doesn't matter. Just ready in case the Lord wants to do something. And you are available. You're not so consumed. And this is the problem I have. I get so consumed in what I think is important. Like I might be thinking show prep's important or getting doing the interview. By the way, the interview with Randy Stonehill next week because you're going to be traveling this week. But anyway, I get so caught up in these things that I do not make myself as available to the Lord. It's not just thinking spiritually. It's being aware that the Lord may want to use you in a moment. And it's a lot of growing up as a Christian, and I encourage everybody to do it. I'm trying to do it. I hope you do it with me. D, draw closer to the Lord daily. N, never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. A, always be ready to serve. Got that? Okay. Your trivia question, who was the father of Cain, Abel, and Seth? Genesis chapter 4, verse 1 through 2, if you think you know the answer. You can reach out to us. You can call 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483 or send an email, david@hemustincrease.org, to Romans chapter 7. And before we pick it up right at verse 8, because we're technically supposed to be picking it up at verse 8, I just want to key in on something that's really, really important. And Paul said this in verse 7, so I don't want you to, I guess, miss this. And this is kind of a real critical element, okay? He says this, well then, am I suggesting the law of God is evil? Of course not. The law is not sinful, but it was the law that showed me my sin. I would never have known that coveting was wrong if the law had not said, do not covet, verse 8. But sin took advantage of the law and aroused all kinds of forbidden desires within me. If there was no law, sin would not have had that power. Here's what I want you to understand. I want you to not miss what the very first part of verse 8 says. It's super super theologically important. One thing we do on this show is teach whatever's in front of us, preach whatever's in front of us, reach whatever's in front of us. Here's what's in front of us. Sin took advantage. Now, people think of sin as something, it's just something we've done wrong. And because it's something that we've done wrong, it's kind of like a bad principle. I'm not convinced that is the theology of sin. And I can take mine all the way back to Cain and Abel, where God said to Cain that sin wants to take advantage of you. you must master it. Sin has an appetite. It's hungry, and it takes advantage of people that step into it. In other words, when we do something that's sin, anything contrary to God, not just hamatiar, which is the Greek word to miss the mark, but sin is anything that's contrary to God, not anything God allows, anything contrary to God. Anything that we engage in that's contrary to God feeds the entity of sin. Sin is the open door for Satan. Remember when Jesus said, the prince of this world is coming, he has nothing in me? That's what he's talking about. You see, when we sin, whether you want to call it that or not, I could care less, that's what God calls it, we have an opening, and we have fed sin as an entity, and Satan's access point against us has to do with that sin that we operate in. Does that mean that you're not saved? No. It just means that we're giving up ground in a walk with Jesus that we don't have to. It means that we're getting deceived. We're getting sideswiped. We're getting, it's like shenanigans on us because sin is taking advantage of us. Sin has an appetite. It must be overcome by the blood of Jesus Christ, by the power and redeeming power from God. But God is trying to communicate to you and I, sin is hungry. It's looking for consumption in our lives. It's kind of like our sin gives it energy. And when we give sin energy in life, we give Satan open opportunities. That's how serious this is. Let me explain something to you. If the result of sin is death, I mean for mankind, how serious is this? It's not a joke. It will separate people from God for all eternity. That's how serious it is. That's pretty serious. No possibility once it's over. Once you're in there, it's over. There's no buying your way or saying your way out once it's done. And that's serious. It doesn't matter who you are. Okay? All right. Who was the father of Cain, Abel, and Seth? The Adam is the answer, or Adam is the answer. The Adam is the answer. You like that? Okay. All right, we're going to take our break, and then we're going to come back. You are listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
What is the David Spoon Experience? Imagine yourself on a rocket ship racing at 1,000 miles an hour into space. Once there, you can sense the power and the presence of the majestic and the divine. You forget about your troubles and your fears, and you just float in peace without a worry in the world. There are no struggles, no pain, no discomfort. It's soothing, calm, comfortable. But then, the show starts. And you realize that none of that stuff has anything to do with the show. What were you thinking? The David Spoon Experience. Only for the brave of heart and the bored.
What is the David Spoon Experience?
So the situation for the woman turned out to be fine. But remember, he's there with Jairus, and Jairus' daughter is dying. Verse 35, while Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader, and said, your daughter is dead. Why bother the teacher anymore? Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, don't be afraid, just believe. This is a situation for Jairus that went from worse to the worst. All right, you know how we said it can go from bad to worse? We were talking about that. Well, it can go from bad to worse to the worst. And this is the worst. The guy's daughter died.
Oh, she wasn't just really sick.
She died dead. And they even said to her, "What? There's no point in talking to this guy anymore. This is over. Situation done." And that's how a lot of us process. Situation done. But then Jesus does what Jesus does because he's so amazing. He overheard what they said to him. They didn't say it to Jesus. They said it to the guy. They said it to Jairus, right? And they said to him, why bother the teacher anymore? Overhearing what they said, Jesus said to Jairus, don't be afraid, just believe. So there are three things that you can't miss this. Number one, Jesus is telling the guy whose daughter just died, ignore them. It's like, can you imagine? Okay. The doctor just pronounced her dead. Yeah, ignore that guy. What? He's the doctor. Ignore that guy. That's just like the blind man who are like, people are telling him, be quiet, stop it, stop it. And he shouts out all the more. It's at some point you just got to ignore any external noise that hasn't been sanctioned by God and just go, yeah, I'm not paying attention to that. Welcome back to the David Spoon Experience. Thank you for joining us here at KAAM 770, the truth station here in Texas. That's KAAM 770, the truth station here in Texas. Getting ready for your next trivia question. Who was the father of Esau and Jacob? Who was the father of Esau and Jacob? Genesis 25, verses 25 through 28. Who was the father of Esau and Jacob? Genesis 25, 25 through 28. If you think you know the answer, 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or send an email, david@hemusincrease.org. Who was the father of Esau and Jacob? Genesis 25, 25 through 28. Okay? All right. Now, don't forget I told you at the bottom of the front page, there's a search engine that's just for the website. Also on the website, there is a place, there's a couple books there. If you want one of those books and you can't afford it, tell us. We will get that for you. No problem. We do know the internet's a little scratchy. Hang in there for that. I do also want you to be aware that after we take probably this caller, we're going to be doing Jake's Take. But I'm doing that because I can. We'll get to that in a second. Let's see. Somebody ready to answer the trivia question? Are they ready? Yes, let's send them on through. Knock, knock, this is David. Who am I talking to?
George.
George, how are you?
Doing great, man. How you doing?
I'm doing phenomenal. I'm doing just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Thank you for asking. I appreciate that. Are you ready for it? I'll set the trivia question up, and then you can answer it, okay?
I'm ready for it. Let's go.
All right, here we go. Who was the father of Esau and Jacob?
That would be Isaac.
That is correct, Imundus! You are right. He was the father. That's a, you know, people read about it and you go through the Genesis portion and you recognize some of the families, maybe not fully functional, maybe a little dysfunctional. They like put the fun in dysfunctional because it's like, right. You got one parent going, I like this kid, the other parent going, I like this kid. And it's like, everybody knew. It's like, yikes.
I had to say it to myself really quick. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I had to say it really fast. Like, okay, it's Isaac.
Excellent job. Well, that's a great way to remember it. So it's an excellent job, sir. Very, very good. Really appreciate it. All right, my brother. God bless. Anything else? You got good? You need prayer?
No, that's it. I'm just glad I got through. A lot of times I'll call in the trivia and not get in. So this is my first. It's awesome. We love you.
Well, welcome on aboard. You call anytime. You're welcome to call. You hear?
Appreciate it, David.
All right. God bless you.
Have a good one. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right. Excellent job. George stepping in. Yeah. That's right. That's a good way to do it. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. That's a good way to do it. All right. Before we do anything else, though, I do have to gloat. I'm not supposed to gloat, you know. Gloating is not part of the it's okay, 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 7. But Since I probably won't be able to gloat this Sunday, I'm going to do it this Tuesday for what happened last Sunday. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for Jake's Take. Jake, you are in charge of Jake's Take. What do you got for me?
Well, David, congratulations. You got the pick right with the Cowboys beating the Pittsburgh Steelers Sunday. It was a two-hour rain delay, so the game wasn't over till midnight. I don't know. You probably didn't finish watching the game, right?
The very end? Nope, I did not have a finish. In fact, I had to find out the next morning that I was going to do this routine. Anyway.
Yeah, I did finish watching it, but I was like, I was hanging on. I was about half asleep, and I watched it. The second the game was over, I said, okay, time for bed.
That's so funny. All right, now, we know, we'll probably do it one more time, we know that this Sunday is the major of the majors because, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, if I am correct, it is Detroit visiting Dallas this Sunday. So we're not going to do our picks yet. We're going to do them on Thursday. But just beware, we've got a major Jake's Take coming up, right?
The last time they played each other was, it was a good game. It was controversial, right, if I remember
that's
right,
correct.
With the officiating, but Cowboys won that one. It was a close game, so I'm looking forward to the rematch. I think it'll be another good game.
I do think it's going to be a good game. I'm with you on that one. Okay, excellent job. Excellent job by George. Everybody doing great. Let's get back into our text. We only have so many minutes, and we want to get to it. Yes, I know. You should see. I mean, I try to get this show like done, but it's like it's 90 minutes. I keep thinking, man, we got to figure out how to expand this. But we'll get there when the time is right. Let's go back to the text. I want you to understand something about sin, okay? I do really want you to understand this, okay? The problem that we think of is we think of sin, and then so images always come into our minds. Like there's an image that people have in regards to sin. That's just a great way to say it. Like people are like, you know, it's like, somebody preaching from a pulpit and you're just a bad person, you know, 50 lashes with a wet noodle kind of mentality. Or sin is like, oh, it's delightful little thingies and it's not a big deal. Or you think about sin, then you think about repentance, and then you think about the guy with the lunch board around saying, repent, the end is near, and so on and so forth. What I don't think Christians necessarily understand, although definitely appreciative because we receive and acknowledge, we receive the authority to become the children of God. That's actually what John chapter 1, verse 12, to as many as believe, he gave the right, the authority to receive being his children. That's a huge, huge, huge deal. What we don't always catch is actually how bad sin is from God's perspective. And the reason I think we don't is because as Christians, we get washed in the blood of Jesus. Okay? I mean, that's the fact. But it took the redeeming work of Jesus Christ to get that washing to take place. So let's understand something about sin. When you think of sin and just even your activities when you blow up before the Lord, you must with it think, not that this is going to happen to you, but the result of sin upon mankind is eternal separation from God. Never connecting to God, ever. A person never being able to connect to God. You have to think of, if you've ever witnessed or been a part of, death, that decay, that composition of death, disease, sickness, the mental sicknesses that take place in our society, all of that, plus the obstruction of nature, the obstruction of how it should be, the contradictions that take place, what should be peaceful, loving, and awesome, which has turned out to be, in many ways, miserable and disgusting. All of that dreck is because of sin. That's the thing that God is trying to teach us. When Adam and Eve sinned by that simple, disobedient command, the disobedience of that command, it wasn't as though at the moment the universe stopped for them, but their fellowship with God stopped, and that then would result in an eternal banishment or an eternal problem for the people of that nature, have the same nature. In other words, everybody born from Adam and Eve is going to have that nature of rebellion in him. And that is what separates mankind from the garden. Jesus, being the second Adam, brought it back into focus, brought it back so we can live like the right way we want to live, eternally with God, for God, and unto God. But it is that sin, that simple moment of yea hath God said, and then just doing that action, that small action of consuming that fruit, eating that fruit, then brought millions and millions and millions of deaths, disease, disgust, darkness. Every time we sin, we reinforce that. Now, you're redeemed if you're a Christian. Totally cool. Don't miss what I'm saying. But I want us to also glimpse the truth that sin is dark. Darker than everything you think is dark is only that way because of sin. And that's what the Lord's trying to teach us. Chapter 7 is making sure you and I understand this is serious to God. And if we think it's cool to be with the Lord, we need to heed what he says is serious. And being friends with sin is serious and not okay. Now, if you're struggling with a besetting sin, if you're listening to me and you're like, Dave, I really am trying to get through this, but I'm really having a hard time. God knows that, and you bring that to him in prayer. Don't be dishonest about it. Be as honest as you can possibly be, and pray and ask for help. You may find immediate deliverance, and you may find the Lord teaching you step by step, but don't deny it. Acknowledge it, confess it, surrender it to the Lord. He will get you through it. And I know there's some of you out there right now, listen to my voice. You're in a bondage. Nobody knows. Only you know. Only God knows. How do I know that? I'm one of you. But none of those sins in our lives own us. And God not only forgives, but frees us from the power of that sin. Get that? Got to get that. Okay? All right. Take a short break, then come back. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
Since the dawn of the internet, people have been looking for a website they can be proud of without costing an arm or a leg. People want a quality website to promote their ministry, business, hobby, or passion. Introducing Cowpunch Sites. Cowpunch Sites can help you create and maintain a quality website. From design to security, Cowpunch does it all. Cowpunch is a family-owned and operated business, taking a fresh approach to business. Lots of clients at lower prices. Make mom happy.
The most significant benefit of working with Cowpunch Sites is that you work with real people, not cheesy templates. No outsourcing. It's $57 a month, and there's no setup fee and no cancellation fees. When you go to cowpunchsites.com/dad, that's cowpunchsites.com/dad. That's me. Oh, did I mention that it's $57 a month? Cowpunch Sites, $57 a month, and that's no bull.
Dave, this is a nice radio station.
Oops, sorry. That's Cowpunch Sites, $57 a month, and that's no baloney. There, that's better. Cowpunchsites.com/dad.
This KAAM radio show with your very own David Spoon is not a business, but a nonprofit ministry first and foremost committed to sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ and strategically equipping the saints. Our mission is to educate, encourage, and entertain Christian believers, the hurting, and those not yet believers who need biblical truths. To continue our radio ministry and message of truth, we need many of our faithful listeners to support us, as well as ministry partners who might wish to sponsor the He Must Increase ministry. By giving, you wonderfully facilitate our priorities of assertively teaching the Word of God, and you get nothing in return. No quid pro quo. Nothing but a receipt at year end indicating you gave to us, since your donation is 100% tax deductible. Remember that it says in Corinthians that whoever sows generously will also reap generously, or in Proverbs where it teaches that a generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. But if you cannot give, no problem. Continue to enjoy and learn and give however you see fit whenever you can. To support us, go to hemustincrease.org. That's hemustincrease.org. Such support is terribly appreciated, knowing it enables our beloved David Spoon to give to all of us his time, energy, like so few can, right here on KAAM.
Welcome back to the David Spoon Experience. Thank you for joining us here at KAAM 770, the truth station here in Texas. That's KAAM 770, the truth station here in Texas. Here is your next trivia question. Oh, no. Now we got to go a little tougher. Just a little tougher. Okay? A little tougher. All right? Okay. Ready? Okay. Who was the father of Manasseh and Ephraim? Who was the father of Manasseh and Ephraim? Genesis chapter 41, verses 51 and 52. Who was the father of Manasseh and Ephraim? Genesis 41, 51 through 52. If you think you know the answer, 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. So I am going to send you up to the website because I haven't done that yet because I talk a lot. That's why. All right. On the website, there's a place for prayer requests and praise reports. Nobody gets your information, just privately to us, nowhere else. That's number one. Number two, there's lots of books up there, and not a lot. There's five of them. If you want any of them, you let us know. If you cannot afford it, we will get them for you. The first one is A Spoon for Jesus. Next one is Broken for His Glory, The Jewish Christian. Also, The Faith That Pleases God, which is probably my favorite, ultimately. And then also, One Step Closer to Jesus. All of those have a purpose to them, and two of the five are also on audio. We're still working. We're going to be working on the third one pretty soon. Last thing to tell you is money.
Money.
How much do I love talking about money?
Not at all.
But that's not the point. The point is we need the money to keep the ministry going. And everybody knows, especially before an election, things get tighter because people aren't sure what's going to be happening. We appreciate that, but we don't care in the context of, well, whatever is going to happen, we trust God knows exactly what he's doing, and we still need the support. So if you're able to give, do so. And if you can't, don't. But pray for us because that's cool. So you should be doing that, right? If the ministry is a blessing for you, please pray for us. Our passage, 2 Corinthians 8:3, I testify according to their ability and beyond their ability, they gave of their own accord. Whenever you give to us or anybody else, you do it because you want to, and you do it unto the Lord. When you give it unto the Lord, it's a covenant between you and God, right? If the ministry doesn't use the money wisely, that's going to be between them and God. But you give unto the Lord. That's how the Lord wants it. You bring it to where the Lord wants you to bring it. And that's between you and him then at that point. That's all I'm trying to say. Okay, check it out on the website, hemustincrease.org.
Prayer request?
Hemustincrease.org.
Praise report?
Hemustincrease.org.
Looking to give to this ministry?
Hemustincrease.org.
Confused by what's happening right now?
Hemustincrease.org.
Hemustincrease.org.
Hemustincrease.org. They're moving in herds. They do move in herds.
They move in herds. They do move in herds. All right. Somebody is ready to answer a trivia question. Let's send them on through. Knock, knock. This is David. Who am I talking to?
Hi, doctor. This is Fred.
Hello, Fred. How are you, brother?
I'm doing fine, sir.
Oh, that's good. Did you have a nice weekend?
Great. Can't complain.
All right. And you know what? Complaining wouldn't help anyway.
No, it would not.
Excellent job. Okay, here we go, my friend. I'll set it up for you. You can knock it out. Who was the father of Manasseh and Ephraim?
This man is probably the polar opposite of, let me say, Solomon and probably Samson, too. But this has got to be the amazing Joseph who never failed God.
That is correct, Manasseh! The one person you look at all the stuff in the Old Testament in Genesis and you think, how that guy, what a rock star that guy was.
Yes, he was a rock star. You know, Satan, he knows man's weakness. And a lot of times we got to admit in the Old Testament, he'd bring a woman. And we're not blaming the woman. The woman can't make the man do anything. But he's tempted, and a lot of the times he fails. But Joseph stood his ground, and I'm proud of Joseph. He can represent us anywhere.
I mean, if you just consider, I mean, that guy, I mean, just, it's amazing. And then all the things he had the opportunity to take revenge, do this. Nope. I'm just going to go about this. This is part of God's plan. Boy, I wish I could have that attitude in every trial. Don't you?
Like, you know what? I think that's what God wants to be. But right now, we're working progress.
Yeah, that's right, brother. That's right. Excellent job, my brother. Excellent job.
All right, God bless you. I'm hanging up and listening.
All right. Thank you, bro. God bless. Right. Bye-bye. All right, folks. We are tight on time, so we are going to go right to this one other thing. And people are like, wait. No, I can't do anything about it. I'm so far. I talk a lot. What do you want from me?
The worst part about it is it never stops.
Don't you feel bad for Noel? I do. All right. Anyway, going back to this, I want to go to verse 9. I don't want you to miss this. And yes, we teach on sin and we teach on redemption. We teach on all of it. All of it. The up and the down. The good, the bad, the ugly. All of it. Why? Because God put it in his word. He put it in there for a reason. Verse 9 of Romans 7. Now, keep in mind, we're heading to a very certain point. We're going to get to Romans 7, and then we're going to have this huge shift in how Paul's talking about it. Because right now, he's talking about it very theologically. But he's moving into this realm of talking about it very personally. So watch. He says this. Verse 9. He said, I felt fine when I did not understand what the law demanded. But when I learned the truth, I realized I had broken the law and was a sinner, doomed to die. So the good law was supposed to show me the way of life. Instead, it gave me the death penalty. Sin took advantage of the law and fooled me. It took the good law and used it to make me guilty of death. But still, the law itself is holy and right. And good. Okay. See, people are like, what? Why is this so exciting to you? Why do you think this is fascinating? I'll tell you why it's fascinating. God brings the law to mankind so that mankind can know the differential between right and wrong. That law helps us understand good, bad, good, bad, good, bad. Sin takes advantage of us when we do the bad and then produces in us activities that are bad. And without the law, we wouldn't know it's bad. So Paul goes, well, I felt fine when I didn't understand it. I felt fine when I didn't understand what the law demanded. And then he says this, but when I learned the truth, I realized. So I want to talk to you about this, and this is going to be mature Christian material. So if you're younger in the faith and you have no idea what I'm talking about, just bear with us. If you're really older in the faith, you should know exactly what I'm talking about. We catch that we have been delivered from the penalty of sin, and we are in the process of being delivered from the power of sin. In other words, we already have that, but we don't access it all the time. And eventually, we will be delivered from the presence of sin. That's the glorification. We won't have to deal with it anymore. It's over. But in the meantime, the penalty is taken care of in Christ. The presence will be removed in all eternity, but the power of sin is what we're dealing with now. What Paul says is, I learned the truth and I realized when the Lord reveals to you something that you're doing that's not great. Okay, let me say it differently. When the Lord shows you that you're sinning, that doesn't mean it's the end of the universe. It means that the Lord is showing you, and then you realize it, and that means it's time for growing up. That means it's time to mature. That means it's time to step up. And I will say this, whether you've been a Christian for 4 years or 40 years, that continues until you are exactly like Jesus in every possible and conceivable way, which means it will continue on this side of glory. And when the Lord shows you something, he's not doing it to take away fun. He's not doing it to express displeasure. He only reveals these things to us so that we can be more like Jesus, and he only does that because he loves us. And when we learn the truth and realize, that's when we're supposed to come before the Lord, own it, and ask for help. And for those that are thinking, well, this is probably only talking about those major addictions and things like that, ridiculous. I'm talking about fear. I'm talking about doubt. I'm talking about a lack of confidence for the future. I'm talking about not operating in a faith that pleases God, praying a prayer, not really expecting the prayer to be answered. I'm talking about not living in the hope that God has established for us, which is supposed to be the anchor to our soul. All of those are as bad, if not worse, than those obvious outward sins, because all those sins sneak their way into our lives. And we need to fight against those. The Lord will never abandon you. He'll never forget you. He'll never forsake you. But he'll never stop working on you. And until you can say, everything is possible to him who believes, and nothing is impossible for God, and really live that, he will keep on working on you. Get it? And you know what? That's because he loves you. That's a good thing, not a bad thing. All right, we'll take our break, and then we'll come back. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the true station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere. Can't stand the skill. Let's get into our text. Colossians chapter. We covered everything, right? Okay. Colossians chapter 3, verses 2 through 4. Whatever you do, or I'm sorry, it's actually Colossians 3:24. Whatever you do, do it enthusiastically. Is something done for the Lord and not for men, knowing that you will receive the reward of an inheritance from the Lord because you serve the Lord Jesus Christ. The scripture tells us that whatever we do, now we've gone through this a couple of times and we have to go through it multiple more times to really grasp it, but that phrase, whatever we do, happens to mean whatever we do. That's what it means. And we're supposed to do it enthusiastically, with an eagerness, not with an obnoxiousness, with an eagerness to do it as unto the Lord. So the things that we're required to do that we have to do, there should be a disposition, an attitude of enthusiasm that is connected to the Lord. It's not that you like to do everything, but if you can understand that in the doing of it unto the Lord, you're doing it with a different priority in mind. You understand that? In other words, what you do, do it unto the Lord, and do it with this attitude of a full heart and an eagerness. I had somebody, I'll say her name, Susie Lopez was at KPRZ. She was the direct marketing director. Susie did the marketing director for San Diego. She said something to me one time that was so profoundly simple, it was irritating, because I had to do something for a client because that's what you had to do at Salem, and I was like, blah. All right, so she said, Dave, she goes, if you can't get out of it, get into it. And it was like, that was really good advice. If you can't remove yourself from it and you have to do it, at least do it right. I mean, do what you're going to do and do it with the right attitude. Do it with the right spirit. Do it with this better mindset. And I think she was more right than wrong. No, I'm not talking about doing bad things or anything like that. So stop. That's weird stuff. I'm talking about doing it as unto the Lord and recognizing that when you do it that way, it is from the Lord and only the Lord that you will receive the true eternal reward. You might go through whatever your process is, but when you do it as unto the Lord, you can recognize that the Lord is the one that brings the reward. And that's just living your life for the Lord. And that's just good, right? I mean, that can't be a bad thing.
The David Spoon Experience.
You're here when I need you the most. When I need you the most. I never
Welcome back to the David Spoon Experience. Thank you for joining us here at KAAM 770, the truth station here in Texas. That's KAAM 770, the truth station here in Texas. Last trivia question coming up right now. Here we go. Who was the father of Joseph and his brothers? Who was the father of Joseph and his brothers? Genesis chapter 30, verse 25. Who was the father of Joseph and his brothers? If you think you know, 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483 or send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. Who was the father of Joseph and his brothers? Who was daddy for all of them kiddies? That is the question that is being asked right now. We'll give you a couple seconds to reply to that. We do have people that are on the phone, people that are answering by text. So I do want to point this out. There's only one really important thing I need to talk about for the history. So we're going to do just the history, and I'm just going to give you one thing, and then we'll take the caller. Okay, so do
let's
history.
Go live it in the past. Let's go live it in the past.
Knowing that we discussed how I do have a very deep and fond element for peanut butter, today is National Flutter Nutter Day. Flutter Nutters are peanut butter and marshmallows. Can't beat that. Sorry.
No, can't beat that.
I mean, come on. Flutter Nutters! That's just awesome. All right, your trivia question. Who was the father of Joseph and his brothers? Genesis 30, verse 25. And we do have somebody on the line, so let's send them on through. Knock, knock. This is David. Who am I talking to?
Hi, Dr. David. This is Joy-Ann.
Hi. Joy-Ann. How are you?
I'm very blessed, and I am so excited to answer this question.
All right, get ready. Here we go. Who, it might be whom, but who was the father of Joseph and his brothers?
Well, back then, he might even have his name prefaced as Jamin, and he could also have the distinction of being like your chief engineer, your co-pilot there at the station. How about Jacob?
That is correct. Am I now? The preface of jamming. That was a good one. That was a good one right there. I'm going to give you mucho props for that one. That's funny.
Thank you.
Very, very funny. Very funny. How are you doing? How art thou?
Oh, just so blessed, loving our new place. And the lungs don't burn anymore. No more mold issue. And so praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I do have a quick prayer request.
Yep.
I did injure my leg while moving a few weeks ago, and it hasn't gotten better. My right leg hurts from my hip down to my toes. It has radiating pain. But I know the Lord will help solve that problem.
Yep. So let's pray for that right now. So where exactly did you get hurt? You hurt your leg or your hip? Which part of it?
Yes. Well, actually, my groin area, and then over the past 4 weeks, it's like radiated from my hip all the way down
okay.
to my toes. So, so the Lord will help me, but it slows me down. I have more boxes to unpack.
Okay. Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's do it.
Okay.
Father, we come before you right now. We thank you for Joy-Ann. We thank you for Cordelia. We thank you for their love. They're just great, great, great sisters in the Lord, period. Just wonderful part of our family. And Lord, you know every nuance of what took place and how Joanne hurt herself and where the pain is, where it originates, how it generates and how it's creating difficulty. And Lord, it's we think, oh, well, that's such a little thing. It's not little to you, Lord, because it's important to her. And so because it's important to her, it becomes important to you, or it always has been, essentially. And we ask you, Lord, to bring the healing power that comes through the stripes that were laid upon Jesus Christ through the truth that your name is Jehovah Rapha, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, because it is by the power of the Spirit these things get done. We are asking you in the name of Jesus that you would manifest your power, your healing power, in her body. Lord, it's stopping her. It's hindering her. It's discouraging in its own way. Knock out the discouragement and the distraction so she can just be about the things that she's supposed to do. Let her have that immediate relief, because you are a God that heals, and we need your healing power in her life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Amen. Oh, I've received that spot on. That's exactly what I needed. Thank you, Dr. David.
You are
well, love you all, and looking forward to the next broadcast. Wonderful.
God bless
Bye-bye.
You. Bye-bye.
Blessings. Thanks.
All right, so for everybody to remember, now this is important, I'm not going to be answering texts till after 4 today, okay? So I'm just telling you up ahead of time. And then the last thing I want to say about this teaching, I know Romans is a little bit of a bog down. People don't spend a ton of time in 7. Typically they'll do Romans 7 in 2 or 3 shots. We've already done 7 or 6 of them. Here's the bottom line. If you are struggling with sin, it's a drag. But there is forgiveness and redemption and healing in Jesus Christ. If you're a long-time Christian with a very long-time sin, bring it before the Lord. He knows. He still chose you. He loves you. And he'll still, at this point, help you overcome. You have to believe that he loves you that much. Okay? All right. All right, we're done for today. You've been listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the truth station here in Texas. 22 and a half hour break, then we'll come back. More insanity with Spoonanity. Talk to you then. Destroying everyone and everything he finds. He's the hungry giant. He's the hungry. The views expressed on the preceding program were those of the speakers and not necessarily those of KAAM, DJRD Broadcasting, or its sponsors.